Hi, and welcome to today's session. My name is Melissa Mello. I'm the coordinator here in the Rady Faculty of Health Science Family Center, and my pronouns are she and her. Thanks for joining us today on our lunch hour for our second session in the Let's Talk About Menopause series. This series is meant to start the menopause conversation, reduce the stigma, raise awareness, and support women during this transition. Menopause will affect a large majority of our workforce. And as Dr. Ivaniak mentioned in our first session, the average length of symptoms is 7 to 8 years long. So that's a large chunk of our time in the workforce. So that brings us to today's topic, menopause in the workplace. We have three facilitators with us today. First, we'll have Brian Weeb, Manager of Employee Wellness. Brian's going to offer an overview of the workplace accommodations. Then we have Dustin Luckwell, Benefits Specialist. Dustin's going to discuss the supports available through our staff benefit plan and EAP program. And lastly, we have Lani Jones, the Rady Faculty of Health Science HR consultant. She'll be moderating the Q&A period, and she'll be able to answer any HR-related questions or bounce them to the appropriate person. So if you could please wait to the end to ask any questions you have, feel free to raise your hand at that time or use the chat function. You can also send Lani a private message if you like, and she can read the question on your behalf. I also just want to let everybody know that we are recording the presentation part of this session, and then I'll stop the recording before the question period so that that portion is not recorded. And before I pass this session on to Brian, I just want to do a land acknowledgement. The University of Manitoba campuses are located on the original lands of Anishinaabe, Cree, Oji Cree, Dakota, and Dene's people, and on the homeland of the Métis Nation. We respect the treaties that were made on these territories. We acknowledge the harms of the past, and we dedicate ourselves to moving forward in partnership with Indigenous communities in a spirit of reconciliation and collaboration. And now here's our first presenter, Brian Weeb.
Hey, thanks, Melissa, and welcome everyone. Today our topic is menopause supports in the workplace. And one of the things I want to mention right off the hop is that I am not an expert on menopause itself. There was a session last week, and I think there was a lot of good information provided by Dr. Ivaniak regarding that. While I do have three adult daughters and a wife and a mom, I am comfortable, fairly comfortable talking about women health issues, but again, not an expert per se regarding menopause. So I do have a lot of experience on workplace accommodation, and the good news is the way we manage accommodation requests for menopause-related health issues is really no different than other health situations. And we have a process in place that really is the same for all types of medical conditions. So I'm going to talk to you about that process, and but before I do, I want to give you a little information about Employee Wellness. So Employee Wellness is a small department within a very much bigger department of human resources. Currently, there's three of us in Employee Wellness. As Melissa mentioned, I'm the manager. We have Jeannette Philippe, who's our Employee Wellness Specialist. She started with us last August, came on board from Canada Life, so she has a lot of experience with LTD, long-term disability claims. And then we have Katie Graham, who just started with us 2 or 3 weeks ago. She came from Workers' Compensation Board, so she has a lot of experience managing workplace injury claims and return to work. So the three of us work in Employee Wellness. We have a shared email address, which is at the bottom right corner of this slide, employee.wellness@umanitoba.ca. So if you have questions or concerns related to medical leaves, accommodations, you can, best way to contact us is to send an email to that shared email address. So who can request an accommodation? Well, any employee with a disability that is impacting their ability to carry out their duties may request an accommodation. And disabilities could be physical, like a broken leg, or non-physical, say mental health related issues. They might be visible, it might be a visible disability or invisible. In fact, probably most of our disabilities that we are managing or dealing with are invisible. And limitations might be temporary or permanent. So Disability has a pretty broad meaning. Any illness, injury, or condition that impairs a person's ability to perform the daily functions of life. So if you have some functional limitations that are impacting work in some way related to a medical condition, you might be entitled to request an accommodation. Employers have a duty to accommodate employees who have limitations related to a disability. It is a fundamental legal obligation. It's deeply entrenched in human rights legislation, human rights laws. Employers and unions are required to make every reasonable effort to accommodate an employee who has a mental or physical disability. So if you do have a medical condition that's leaving you with some functional limitations that are impacting you, your job or your work, we have established a form that you can complete that you would provide to your supervisor and send a copy to Employee Wellness. And it basically asks for information in four main areas. One, looking to identify what the functional limitations that you're experiencing related to your medical condition. How those limitations are affecting you and your job, specific job tasks that you are finding are problematic in view of those limitations. And if you have some ideas as to accommodations that you believe will help or eliminate these problems, you want to outline that in the form. And, you know, you may have had some conversations with your healthcare provider about your medical situation and how it's impacting you, maybe at home or at work. And your healthcare provider may have some suggestions for how you might best manage that and may even have some suggestions for accommodations in the workplace. So this is a form to help initiate the accommodation process. So you would complete that, again, send it to your supervisor, copy to me. It doesn't ask for any specific medical information such as a diagnosis or treatment plan. That's confidential health, your own confidential medical information. Employees can share what they feel comfortable sharing, but they're not required to provide information such as diagnosis or treatment plan, that type of thing. So what you will likely be asked to provide in support of your accommodation requests is something from your healthcare provider that provides an outline of the general nature of your condition. Again, not a diagnosis, but you know, if you're dealing with, say, for instance, a back condition, you know, that is related to, you know, a muscular back problem or something. And we don't need a diagnosis, like it's an L4 or 5 disc protrusion or anything like that. So just a general description of your medical condition, a description of the limitations that are associated with that medical condition, whether the condition is considered temporary or permanent, and if it's temporary, what is the expected duration of the limitations? And, you know, any recommendations that your healthcare provider might have for accommodations in the workplace that might help reduce or eliminate the problems related to the condition. A lot of times when we get medical notes from healthcare providers regarding accommodation needs, they provide the fourth bullet point there, the recommendations for accommodations. But we really need to know what the functional limitations are and the duration of those. Because quite often there's more than one accommodation that we might be able to consider for you. And, you know, while it's appreciated that the healthcare provider spells out what they think the accommodation should be or could be, really we do need to know what the functional limitations are so that we can turn our mind to what the different options might be. So once we get that form, the request for accommodation form from the employee and medical information from the healthcare provider outlining the limitations, the next step would be for Employee Wellness, myself, to discuss this request with your supervisor and the HR consultant for your area. We would talk about what the potential accommodations are that are available. Maybe there's additional information that might be needed for us to better assess what types of accommodations might be available. If it's relatively straightforward, and an accommodation plan is available, readily available, your supervisor might then just meet with you and confirm that they're able to meet your request for accommodation and put it in place. If it's a little more complicated, if we need a little more information, we may set up an accommodation planning meeting that would be with you, your union representative, if you're in a union, your supervisor, employee wellness, myself, and the HR consultant for your area. And at that meeting, we try to gather the information we need to determine what types of accommodations could potentially be looked at. The employer has this duty to accommodate, as I mentioned. So when we do receive the request, we accept those requests in good faith. We try to act quickly once we know what the needs are. Sometimes we might put in place some temporary accommodations while we're gathering information. We might need some additional medical information or other information related to your accommodation needs, but quite often we'll put things in place in the meantime. If we're able to, and ask for information that we need around your accommodation needs, and then actively search for solutions to your request. So specific to menopause, should it be an occupational concern? In most cases, the answer is probably no, that in most cases, there's little or no impact on an employee's ability to do their job. However, for others, there might be some impacts on their health, performance, and attendance that that we should be looking at potential accommodations. And as Dr. Vaniak had mentioned in her, or likely presented in her session last week, she probably went over some of the symptoms that could include hot flashes, muscle aches, poor concentration, anxiety, and headaches. And all that can lead to, fatigue, lower energy, lower performance, or poor mental health. So with that in mind, there potentially could be accommodation needs. There's other changes that could occur with menopause. And again, I'm not expert on the medical condition itself, but from the literature out there, there can be cardiovascular changes, lower bone density, some incontinence issues, hot flashes, sleep disturbances. All of those things could impact, employees in the workplace. And we might need to take a look at things such as, the physical tasks of a job, the work environment, accessibility to washrooms, maybe adjusting hours of work, more recovery time between shifts, things like that. So it really is dependent on the functional limitations that the employee is experiencing, how it's impacting them at work, and what types of accommodations are thought might help either reduce or eliminate those types of problems. Some of the other areas for consideration, looking at ventilation, humidity, air conditioning, maybe moving an individual into another area where there's better temperature control, making sure that they have easy access to washrooms. So again, that might be an issue of relocation. Looking at the general environment, maybe we need better lighting controls. Perhaps headaches is an issue associated with menopause, and maybe different lighting might help address that. Access to cold water, quiet space. Looking at work flexible hours, maybe a later start time, later finish time in the workday might be helpful. Hybrid work from home. Since the pandemic, we've had lots of requests for work from home, and many of those are tied in with medical conditions that are better suited for work from home, either on a hybrid basis or more. Shorter, more frequent breaks could be considered. Maybe we need to look at the individual's duties and make some adjustments to workload, tasks, and duties. So these are all kinds of things that we can take a look at, and our ability to meet accommodation requests will vary from area to area. Ultimately, employee wellness will rely on the department and the HR consultant to help determine what types of accommodation options are available and are doable. But we, our role is to work with the employee, with the union, with the HR consultant, and the management to see what's available, determine what will work, and ultimately decide on the most reasonable accommodation that can be put in place. So sometimes it's not the preferred accommodation that, you know, we often get a request for something very specific. But when we start looking at the functional limitations and the different options available, it may be decided that, you know, a different accommodation would work better, maybe operationally. So it's not always the preferred accommodation that's put in place, but we want to make sure it's a reasonable accommodation that addresses, you know, both the employee needs and also operational needs as well. So that's a very quick snapshot of the accommodation process. I know that Dustin's going to speak to you a little more about staff benefits and some of the supports that are available through our benefit program. And I know, Melissa, you had mentioned we'll save questions for the end. So I think I'll just turn it over to Dustin and see if there are questions at the end of the presentation.
Go ahead, Dustin.
All right. Thank you so much. Thank you, Brian. So just to before I start here, I'm just going to get my presentation queued up. Just 1 second. Right. Okay. All right. And I'm just going to rely on my co-host here. Does everything look good?
Okay. Oh, sorry, you'll just have to click it. Yeah.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Melissa. So obviously, I'm here this afternoon. I'm actually very honored to be included this afternoon. I see a number of familiar names in our attendees this afternoon, so that's great. And I just feel really, really honored to be a part of this so that we can get some information out there about our benefit plans. Just echoing what Brian had said, I can't say that I've got a personal stake here or personal experience with menopause, but I did have a very, very close relationship with my mom. My mom's been gone now about 4 years. And when I was included in this presentation, of course, I wanted to give that phone call to my mom and say, Mom, if I could talk anything about menopause, what would you want me to say? And I think what my mom would say is that she would say, well, you know what? She said, I think that you would really want to emphasize the fact that menopause isn't just a women's health issue. And the reason why I say that is because of the fact that women's health is a concept that actually has ripple effects throughout all of our different groups and communities. So if we're celebrating and making sure that women have access to the information that they need as they go through this time in their lives, it's going to impact all of us in ways that have a huge ripple effect. So I just wanted to make that statement. When you're supporting a woman and a woman's health, it actually goes very, very far beyond that. So just to get into some of the supports that we have available in our supplementary health, healthcare spending account, and EFAP plans for you. And also, too, just to say, I am going to be sharing some contact information for the benefits office in a later slide. So of course, you can certainly feel free to raise questions about this as we get to the end of the session. If you don't feel comfortable raising it in session or you prefer the personalized approach, then you can certainly feel free to reach out to us anytime if you have questions or concerns about any of the information we're about to go through here. Oh, and so I think I just went a little too fast here, so I'm just going to back this up. Just bear with me here. The health benefits really are comprised of the supplementary health plan and the healthcare spending account. So under supplementary health, we have paramedicals, we have drugs, we have the medical supplies and services coverage. We've also got the healthcare spending account here. So just to give everybody in the room an idea of what kind of information they should have if they're under our supplementary health plan with Canada Life, everybody should have a drug card that's going to look very similar to what you see here. You're going to see our plan number, member number, and you're going to see your name on there. If you are also the eligible spouse of a staff member of the university, you'd also be having a spouse card as well that's very similar to this. So this is just to give everybody an idea of what should be in your wallet if you're a plan member. If you are a part of our benefits plan but you do not have this card, please feel free to reach out to us and we'll be happy to give you the information for the insurance company so that you can request one. It's important for you to have if you're going to the pharmacy or drugstore to fill a prescription, if you're going to an appointment such as for physio, chiropractic, massage, acupuncture, anything like that, you want to have this card so that they can direct bill the insurance company. Now, just to let everybody know a little bit more about the paramedical benefits that are available under our health plan, these are actually in line with the plan enhancements that have just been recently announced effective April the 1st. So prior to April the 1st, our paramedical coverage was all lumped together for full-time staff. You had a $500 combined annual maximum for everything combined. So that $500 isn't a lot of room and would include things like physio, chiropractic, massage, psychologists, social workers, dietitians, acupuncturists, osteopaths. There was quite a big list of them. And so all you would get back every year is $500. So $500 back in your pocket. So an enhancement that's been made to the plan effective April the 1st is something that I'm personally really, really happy with. But I'm also seeing that it's making a tremendous impact for our plan members. So you'll see here that, that we actually now have different annual maximums in accordance with the services that are actually provided. So if you're full-time, you're going to have a total annual maximum here of $3,000 per person. If you're part-time, you're going to see a total annual maximum per person of $2,100 here. So you have $500 just set aside alone for chiropractors, $500 for massage therapists, $500 for physio, athletic therapy, and occupational therapists. You've also got another $500 combined maximum for acupuncture, dietitians, naturopaths, osteopaths, podiatrists, and therapists. And you've got $1,000 alone for mental health, which is something that's really, really great. I've already seen a number of our plan members very, very happy about this. So it's $1,000 per policy year that's devoted specifically right now for psychologists and social workers. There's going to be an expanded list of mental health practitioners coming later in 2024. So we're going to be opening that up a little bit more. I'm getting a lot of questions about this from our members, which is great. We really want questions, actually, because of the fact that questions allow us to learn what are the trends, what are the experiences of our plan members, and basically what's important to all of you. So by reaching out to the benefits office and raising questions, you're helping us to learn what's important to our plan members and ultimately what we need to focus on, which is really, really important. So you have a maximum annual paramedical benefit there, and the year for this coverage is April to March. So I encourage you to look into this further. And just to let you know, psychologists and social workers, in order to be covered by the plan, they have to be licensed and registered. If you're considering working with a practitioner that you don't see listed here, I do suggest that you reach out to the benefits office or to Canada Life just to make sure that your services are going to be covered before you actually go and start attending appointments and start putting money out. So very, very important. You want to confirm that before you incur any expenses. Just to expand a little bit more on our supplementary health plan. So first and foremost, I say supplementary. This always throws our plan members off because of the fact that as soon as we throw that word supplementary in there, I think that folks tend to think that we might be talking about the healthcare spending account, which is what we're going to cover in a little bit. But the supplementary health is supplementary in nature to what is provided by Manitoba Health. So supplementary plan like what we've got here at the university is designed to cover things that aren't covered by Manitoba Health. So prescription drug coverage is a big chunk of that. So this is another area where we were able to make some enhancements effective April the 1st. So if you're a full-time staff member, you get 80% coverage. If you're part-time, you get 55%. Prior to April 1st, there was an annual deductible that has now been phased out of the drug benefit completely for active staff members. So no more deductible. It's just 80% for full-time or 55% part-time. And instead of having an individual annual maximum, that's been opened up now too. So that's now your family pharmacare deductible, which is based on your total household earnings. To be eligible for inclusion under the reimbursement for the drug benefit, the drug has to be eligible in the Manitoba PharmaCare formulary. If you're not sure, you can always call Canada Life. They can let you know. In order to do that, they would need the drug name and the drug identification number, or DIN, that's available from your pharmacy. And Canada Life can actually confirm for you if that drug is on the formulary. There's contact information here. We are recording the session, but if you do require this information at a later date, please feel free to reach out to myself and my team. We'll be happy to elaborate for you. So now, just to let you know, if you are prescribed a drug that is not on the formulary, there is a way to get around that. You can actually apply for something called exceptional drug status, or EDS. You actually make that application through your physician. The physician would actually make an application to PharmaCare, and if they're able to approve the exceptional drug status for you, Canada Life will be able to cover the drug as they would any other drug already on the formulary. All you need to do is just provide them with a copy of that approval letter so that they can load it to your file. They would then be able to allow coverage for that particular drug that might not be on the formulary. And moving on from drugs, we've also got semi-private hospital and ambulance coverage. If you're full-time, it's at 100%. If you're part-time, that's 70%. Great. There's a little bit more here about medical benefits. So we do have private duty nursing, up to $5,000 of an annual maximum there. Important to know that the plan doesn't cover home care, but it will cover medically necessary nursing. If you're interested in knowing more or you need to do a pre-approval, just let us know and we can help you with that. We've also got some coverage under this division for breathing equipment, orthopedic equipment, prosthetics, mobility aids, and communication aids. So there's more information there, as well as on our SharePoint site. There, for some of these expenses, there are special claiming instructions. So this is where I say, if it's something that's quite expensive, if it's something that's maybe a little unconventional, or maybe something that's a little unusual, something that's beyond the scope of a benefits booklet, we do try and make our booklets and information available on SharePoint to be as complete as possible. But just for space limitations, we unfortunately can't put all the information in there. So I always say, have a look at our booklet, have a look at SharePoint. If you're not seeing something there that you need more information on, please feel free to reach out to us, and we can put you in touch with the insurance company or get you more information. So you want to make these inquiries if you can before you put any money out, again, just so that we can be sure that the services or supplies are going to be covered for you. So the next item here is the healthcare spending account. This is another area where there have been some enhancements made here. So if you're full-time, your annual allocation is $865 per family. It was previously $825. If you're part-time, it's $620 per year. I believe prior to April 1st, it was $590. Might be incorrect there, but I can always check that. But these are the current annual allocations. So basically, a question I get a lot in the benefits office is, what does the spending account actually cover? The spending account can actually be used to cover any expense that is a medical expense under the Income Tax Act. So as long as it's defined as a medical expense, then the door is open as far as coverage is concerned. So the spending account is used like a bank account, a declining balance for eligible health expenses. I'm not covering dental in this session, but you can also use it for the remaining balance of a dental claim that's not paid by the dental insurer. In our case, it's Blue Cross. So you can use it for different things. Has to be a medical expense. If you are interested in knowing whether something specific is defined as a medical expense or eligible under the plans, then you can certainly feel free to ask us and we'll be happy to elaborate. Just some information here about Canada Life and how to register. So there is an online platform. It's called My Canada Life at Work, formerly called GroupNet. So Canada Life at Work, My Canada Life at Work is great. You can actually file health claims online. You can access 24 months of claims history. You can also have a quick look and just know, is that claim been processed? If it's still pending, is there something else that I need to do here? So if you are wanting to register, then you would just go to Canada Life and click sign in. You'd need your plan and ID numbers that are available from the drug card that I mentioned previously. The plan number is 020778. Your ID number that you need is 4 leading zeros plus your 6-digit university employee number. So when we ask for employee number, that's always the last 6 digits of the longest middle block on your employee or staff card. If you're not sure though and you need help, feel free to send us an email or give us a phone call, and we can always pull your file and access that information, confirm your plan credentials for you if you need them. Moving over to the EFAP or the Employee and Family Assistance Program now, there's an impression out there that the EFAP is just basically for counseling. It's really a much more rounded plan than that. I think that the Employee and Family Assistance Program is just really a one-stop shop for things. I think there's sometimes a perception that somebody's issue or problem might not be big enough for the EFAP. Sometimes maybe there's a perception that it might be too big. We couldn't be any further from the truth. And the reason why I say that is because of the fact that it's a confidential counseling service that allows you to discuss your personal problems and concerns in an understanding and professional environment away from your workplace. And the number one thing about menopause that I remember my mom telling me, she said, I'm going through great physical and emotional changes right now. And really, that really hit a chord with me because of the fact that my mom, I mean, she's my mom. I mean, I'm always going to make sure that I'm there standing up for her and looking out for her best interests. But to know that my mom was having a hard time and it wasn't necessarily something that I could maybe help with. Was really, really difficult. But something like this, just because of the fact that you are going through great personal, physical, emotional, psychological changes. And that's very, very valuable. And as part of that, you want to be able to discuss these changes and issues with somebody who you feel is going to understand, which is very, very important. So it could, along with that, sometimes these might cause maybe some work-related issues. Maybe there's some accommodation supports there that Brian had mentioned. But this is all also like there's just different keys here that all work together. And I encourage anybody and everybody to use the service for whatever that they need from it. For example, personal well-being, managing relationships, addressing workplace challenges, smoking cessation, nutritional support services. So these are all concepts that are kind of there to begin with. But then as soon as we add something like menopause into it, then these things sometimes can become 10 times more difficult to manage. So it's important to know that the EFAP is there for you if you need it. And I've actually used the program myself. Of course, much different reason for that, but it really helped to identify what was going on. It helped to basically say there's other things that are going on here that maybe aren't going to go away on their own, but very, very valuable experience and lots of really great support available from this network. So just as of April the 1st now, or as of May the 1st, I should say, there has been a change in our provider. It's now provided by Key by CloudMD. So there are some online resources here, and there's an access code that you need to use if you want to go the old-fashioned way, which is what I did when I accessed the EFAP a few years back. I made a phone call. They are available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for you. And these services can also be used by any member of your immediate family that's living in the household with you. So for yourself, you can use it. For any family member that's in the immediate family, living in the family home, can use it as well. And again, even though the session is being recorded, there is further information for you on our SharePoint site about this kind of thing. So I do encourage everybody to reach out and see what the program can help with personally. And there's lots of really great supports there that you can use if you need them. So I'm just finishing off with the benefits program now, just letting everybody know where we are and how to reach us. So we're now located in 309 Administration Building at the Fort Garry campus. You can call us at 474-7428, send us an email, benefits@umanitoba.ca. We do have a website, it's on SharePoint, it's under the Employee Resources menu, so you can basically find anything benefits related that you're looking for there. I would just say to just poke around. If you are having trouble finding something or you need further information or support, please feel free to reach out to us anytime. It should also go without saying in this room that, of course, all of the inquiries that we get are confidential and treated confidential at all times. So if you're having an especially tough time, then please feel free to reach out to us. Everything is treated as confidential, and we'll work one-on-one with you to find you the information and the supports and the solutions that you need. So that concludes the benefits portion of the presentation. I'd like to thank you all so, so much and encourage you to reach out to us after the session with questions and also separately beyond today if there's any questions or concerns and if there's anything that we can do to support you. Very important. Thank you so much.